Hello, this is Pastor Jim Bauer from Finchford Community Bible Church. I'd like to welcome you and thank you for joining us today. I want to share with you a message entitled, How to Be Blessed and How to Be a Blessing. I know this is a time of great stress for a lot of people, but I also know it's a time for the children of God to be blessed and to be a blessing. The Greek word for blessed means to be fortunate, to be well off, to be happy. The Hebrew word blessed means to receive a benefit. And when used in connection with God, it means to receive a benefit, a blessing from God. And we, the children of God, are the most blessed, fortunate, well-off people on the face of the earth. And we should be the most happy people on the earth because we have received the blessing of God. And it's available to everyone, and Jesus told us how to receive it. In Matthew 5, Jesus sat down on a mountain with his disciples and a multitude of people, and he started with this: Blessed are the poor in spirit, for they will see the kingdom of God. The Greek word for poor there relates to the actions of a beggar who is bowing down and asking or pleading for something that he cannot obtain by himself. He has a need that he cannot fulfill on his own. And if we are to receive anything from God, we must come with that same attitude as bowing down before him in humility, acknowledging that we have a need that we cannot meet for ourselves, that we have a sin problem that cannot be taken care of by our own efforts. We must acknowledge that we are sinners and that we cannot earn God's favor. There is nothing that we can do on our own to gain his favor and grace. Isaiah had a vision in chapter 6 of his prophecy and said, I saw the Lord high and lifted up. I saw him in his glory. I saw him in his holiness. And when I saw his holiness, I realized how unholy and unclean that I was. Too often in this life, we compare ourselves to other people. We say, well, I'm not that bad. I don't do this. I don't do that. And by comparison to other people, we think that we are living a pretty good life. But the qualification for heaven isn't how well we compare ourselves to other people. It's how well we live up to God's standard and his holiness. We must see ourselves as sinners before we can find any favor with God. The first step to finding favor with God is to acknowledge that we are sinners. Blessed are those who recognize that they are poor in spirit, for only they can inherit the kingdom of God. And then Jesus said, Blessed are they that mourn, for they will be comforted. The word mourn means more than just to be sorry or to be sad about our sin or condition. Many times people are sorry for what they've done or sorry that they've gotten caught or sorry about the consequences of their actions. But that's not godly sorrow. Paul said, we must show godly sorrow, which leads to repentance. Repentance is a desire to turn around, to go the other way. Instead of heading south, I want to head north. Instead of heading for hell, I want to be heading for heaven. A desire to turn around. Instead of living a selfish life, I want to live a sacrificial life that gives to others. Godly sorrow leads to repentance and a desire to change. And Paul said, this is what leads to salvation. Blessed are they that mourn over their sin, not just a sadness, but a desire to change. Jesus said, those that mourn over sin will be comforted. The Greek word there, comforted, means to be invited to draw near. Blessed are those who are mourning because they will be invited to draw near to God. Too often when we sin or make mistakes, we run from God. But that is the time to draw near to God, not to pull back from him. Paul said in Hebrews, draw near to God, and he will draw near to you. Blessed are they that mourn, because they will be invited to draw near to a place of fellowship with God. Paul said that we have a God who is there to comfort us in our time of need. 2 Corinthians 1 said he is the God of all comfort. That is why Jesus said, blessed are they that mourn, they will be comforted, invited to draw near to God. The next verse says, blessed are the meek, for they will inherit the earth. I think we have a very wrong understanding of meekness, and we tend to equate it with weakness. But the Greek word there for meek means the unassuming, the non-demanding. It means to be gentle. I believe the true meaning to desire what God wants, not my will, but thine be done. This is the prayer that Jesus prayed in Luke 22. Lord, it's not about what I want. It's about what you want. We're born with a selfish nature. I want this, I want that. But God's desire is for us to become like Jesus, who said, Lord, I want what you want. God's desire is to put his spirit on the inside of us. Ezekiel prophesied this in chapter 36, verse 26. God said, I will take out that old selfish heart, and I will put my spirit on the inside of you. And the only way that we can have that same attitude that Jesus had, that desire for God's will to be done on earth as it is in heaven, is for the Spirit of Christ to be planted and placed on the inside of us. We must come to a place where we are willing to deny ourselves and to pray for God's will to be done on this earth as it is in heaven. And that's why Jesus said, blessed are the meek, because they will inherit all the blessings of God. Then Jesus said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness. I can remember times when I've been very, very thirsty or very, very hungry. And you come to a place where it's all that you can think about is getting a drink or getting something to eat. Someone who is starving is thinking constantly about food. They diligently search or seek to find it. They're willing to pay any price to have the thing that they're hungering and thirsting for. And Jesus said, blessed are those who are hungering and thirsting, not after the things of the world, but those who are hungering and thirsting after righteousness. Those who have a desire to have right standing and to have favor with God. Those who are hungering for righteousness will be filled. So if you have a hunger or desire to experience the things of God, they're found in Jesus Christ. Jesus said to the woman at the well, I have living water that will lead to eternal life. And Jesus said, if you drink of this water, you will never thirst again. Those who are hungering, thirsting after the things of the world are never satisfied, always wanting something more, something new. But Jesus said, if you drink the water that I have, you will never be thirsty again. Jesus said, I am the bread that came down from heaven, the bread that leads to eternal life. And anyone who eats this bread will never hunger again. That's why he said, those who are hungering and thirsting after righteousness will be filled. And only those who are seeking for this place of righteousness, this right standing with God, will ever find a place of satisfaction in this life. And that's why Jesus said, blessed are those who hunger and thirst after righteousness. They're the ones who will be filled. Those who are hungering and thirsting for the things of this world will never be satisfied. In the next verse, Jesus said, blessed are the merciful, for they will obtain mercy. In Luke 6, Jesus said, we have received incredible mercy from God in that he has forgiven us of our sins, and that we should then also show mercy to others. In the Lord's Prayer, we say this, Father, forgive us of our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. And this is very, very important because right after the conclusion of that prayer, Jesus said, if you do not forgive men their sins, neither will your Father in heaven forgive you of your sins. Freely we have received his forgiveness, and freely we should share that forgiveness and mercy with others. I think that too often we think that we're better than others or we're not as terrible as sinners as others. And that's a very dangerous thought process. Because only when we see our utter sinfulness without Christ will we obtain his mercy. We must realize that we are no better than anyone else. We were all born in sin. And the only difference is that we have been forgiven of sin. We have received his mercy and forgiveness. He has been merciful to us, and we must be merciful to others. Then Jesus said, blessed are the pure in heart, for they will see God. The word pure in heart means to be clean, to be spotless. That's not us. We can't be that. We're not that by our own. David had a desire for that in the Old Testament. In Psalm 51, he said, "Create in me a clean heart. Renew in me a right spirit." And he recognized that we are all born sinners and that we do not have an inherent holiness within ourselves. But yet the Bible says, without holiness, no man can see God. Our only hope of holiness is to receive Christ, who is the Holy One. Jesus is holy, and we're to be holy as he is holy. And by receiving Christ as our Lord and Savior, we receive his holiness, and it abides within us. And that is what gives us the hope that we will see God, that we can stand before God, not having our own righteousness, but having the righteousness which comes from him. We are very blessed to have received a pure heart, a clean heart. It is the gift of God. Paul said in 2 Corinthians 5, if anyone comes into a union with Christ, he's a new creation. The old sinful nature has passed away. All things have become new, and these new things are from God. And we have received a clean heart, a new spirit that David prayed for in Psalm 51. Because he lives in us, we have become holy. And that's why Jesus can say, blessed are those who are pure in heart, because we are the ones who will see, know, and experience God forever. In the next verse, Jesus said, blessed are the peacemakers, for they shall be called the children of God. We are to be peacemakers in this world. Paul said that we are to pursue peace. In Romans 12, Paul said, we have peace with God, and we are to live at peace with others. Paul said, as much as it lies within your ability, live at peace with those around you. In every situation, we should be the ones to try and bring peace. Be the one that tries to calm things down, to try and make things better. Don't be the one that tries to stir things up and get people angry or mad. Say and do the things that bring peace. We've received great peace from God, so we should be the ones to spread peace. In 2 Corinthians chapter 5, Paul said, we are the representatives of Jesus Christ here on the earth, and we are to invite them to make peace with God. That's why Jesus said, blessed are the peacemakers, for they'll be called the children of God. We are the ones as the children of God who should be spreading peace on earth. Number one, peace with God. And number two, let us live in peace with those around us. Be the one who is called a peacemaker. They're the ones who are the children of God. In conclusion, Jesus said, you're the salt of the earth. The purpose of salt is, number one, to add flavor. And number two, to preserve. People add salt to the things that they eat to enhance the flavor that's already there. You should be the one to add flavor to every circumstance and situation where you are. Be the one to make things better, to make things happier, to make things smoother and more fun and rewarding. Jesus said, if the salt doesn't have any flavor, then it's worthless. The second purpose of salt is to preserve. My dad had a meat locker, and we use salt to preserve foods to be used at a later time. And I believe as the children of God, we are the ones who are preserving God's favor on the earth. And when we leave, God's favor will be removed. I believe that the world is being preserved from the wrath and judgment of God because of the flavor that the children of God are adding to the earth. Because we are here, God's favor and blessing remains. And when we're gone, wrath and destruction will come. Jesus said, if the salt has no flavor, if we're not the ones preserving God's goodness on the earth, then it's useless. I'd like to challenge you with this question. What effect do you have on the people around you? Do you add any flavor to their lives? Are you there to preserve God's goodness and blessing in their lives? Do you say and do things that point them towards Jesus Christ? I'd like to challenge you to make every effort, every day, to preserve our peace with men and those around us, and to say and do things that would lead them, encourage them to find peace with God. This is our purpose on the earth. If you want to find peace and satisfaction in this life, say and do things that add the flavor of Jesus Christ to every situation, every circumstance where you are. And use every opportunity to lead people to find peace with God. We are here as the salt of the earth. Let's do the thing that God's asked us to do. We can not only be blessed in these difficult times, but we can be a blessing to others. Use these troubled times as an opportunity to talk to people about the Lord. When they talk about tough times and they talk about discouragement, talk to them about Jesus and His grace and His mercy. Talk to them about peace with God. I thank God for each one of you that are at peace with God. I thank God for the things that I see His children doing around the earth. And I pray more and more that the goodness, the grace, the love, the mercy of God would be revealed to us and through us as we are His representatives here on the earth. Let's pray. Jesus, I come to you knowing that I am the one who is poor in spirit. Lord, and I ask that you would forgive me of my sin. Lord, I repent over the sins that I've committed, my shortcomings, my failings. And Lord, I come humbly before you, and I ask for your continued favor. I haven't earned it. I don't deserve it, but I ask for it in Jesus' name. Not my will, but thine be done on the earth. Lord, I have a hunger and thirsting for righteousness. Lord, I want to say and do those things that are pleasing in your sight. Lord, I thank you for your grace and mercy to me, and I ask you to be merciful to me, to forgive me of my sin, to cleanse me of my sin. Lord, I ask that you would keep me clean by the cleansing power of your blood. I thank you for the Spirit of life that dwells in me because Jesus is my Lord and Savior. I thank you that I have peace with God because of Christ and His work on the cross. Lord, I pray that I would be a peacemaker in every situation. Lord, help me to be salt that adds flavor and the goodness of God to every circumstance that I find. And Lord, I thank you for your goodness and mercy to continue to be poured out on the family of God. May your favor remain on us because of Jesus Christ. I ask it in His holy name. Amen. God bless you, and thank you for sharing this time with us.
So amid the conflict, whether great or small, do not be disheartened, God is over all. Count your many blessings, angels will attend. Help and comfort give you to your journey's end. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Your blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done. Count your blessings, name them one by one. Count your blessings, see what God has done. Your blessings, name them one by one. Count your many blessings, see what God has done.